reform is not just an issue for special interest groups. Electoral reform affects everybody. It affects people who are working on anti-poverty issues. And a shout out to the Food Not Bombs people who will probably be here very shortly, giving food to people who can't afford to buy their own. Grassroots, ground level organization. These people are not getting their voice heard in Ottawa. They need fair representation. They need electoral reform. The Indigenous peoples, we have Native peoples who have been fighting treaties, they've been fighting pipelines, they've been protecting our water, they've been trying to stop the Site C Dam in British Columbia. Native peoples are not having their voices heard. They need fair representation. I would like to just acknowledge that the Native peoples have unceded land here. The Haudenosaunee, the Anishinaabe, the Algonquin people are the original owners of this land, and I thank them very much for making this land available to us for having a protest here today. Thank you. We have environmentalists in the audience. We have people who are fighting for clean water, for keeping the fossil fuels in the ground. Those people's voices are not being heard. They need fair representation, and they're not getting it. We only have electoral reform. Shout out to the Council of Canadians. Thank you for coming here. Council of Canadians is an organization that does all kinds of good work. They're working on water protection right here in our neighborhood. The Guelph Nestle water extraction is one of the things that they're fighting. They are a major proponent for electoral reform as well. We have Green Party people here. We have NDP people here. We have people from all sorts of parties. It is often said that having proportional representation will allow the small parties to rule the parliament. It will allow the tail to wag the dog. In fact, I just heard yesterday Mr. Trudeau, Justin Trudeau, say exactly that thing. He said that if we have proportional representation, it is entirely likely that we're going to get fringe parties of 15, 20, 25 seats in parliament. If a party has 10, 15, 25 seats, that's not a fringe party. That's a powerful voice for the people. People who want fair representation. And they're not getting it today. And it doesn't look like Mr. Trudeau wants to allow that to happen. Mr. Trudeau said that Ms. Leach, Kelly Leach, would we want her to have her own party? Would that be a fringe party? This is the Conservative Party of Canada. One of the major players in Canadian politics. That is not a fringe party. And do you know that the Conservative Party of Canada does not have fair representation in Parliament? They've been denied seats because the Liberals have a majority of the seats in Parliament with only a minority of the votes. The Conservatives need fair representation. Mr. Trudeau pulled out all these arguments against electoral reform, arguments that have been soundly disproven for a very long time, old arguments, arguments that are overripe, arguments that have fallen from the stupid tree and hit every branch on the way down. These are not arguments that have any credence at all. So, if you are a member of any sort of group, if you are a citizen of Canada, and if you want fair representation, I want you to rally here today. I want you to come up, think about something that will affect you and how you can best achieve fair representation for you, for your group, for your family, for your neighbors, and come up and tell us about it. Got a small list of speakers here, people who already have some ideas of how proportional representation will give them a voice in Parliament that they don't have today. So, to start off today, I would like to call up Sam Nabby from the Kitchener Centre Green Party. And if Sam could come up and say a few words how the Green Party has been arguing for proportional representation for a very long time. Give a big hand to Sam.
A lot of us out here today. This is very, very heartening, and I wish we didn't have to be here. For those of you who don't know me, my name is Sam Nabby. I'm the communications chair for Kitchener Centre, Federal Green Party. I've been in Kitchener Waterloo since 2008 when I came here at the University of Waterloo. 2008 happened to be an election year. And that's when I first heard about the issue of fair voting and proportional representation. So it's been 9 years since I, a young person, have heard about this issue and have been fighting for this issue. And so today, the fight is not over. Just because Justin Trudeau has become bored, we're not going to stop fighting for proportional representation. Thank you. So as of this morning, there have been 105,000 signatures on a parliamentary petition supporting the Liberals' own campaign promise and reminding them to perform on this issue. In addition to that, there were 383,000 people that responded to the government's own My Democracy survey, which has its flaws, but what was the number one recommendation that came out of that? The one thing that the respondents agreed on most, with 70% support, is that what we want most is parties that cooperate and work together. Let's give a shout out to that. And on Prime Minister Trudeau's listening tour of Canada, in every single city that he stopped at, people brought up the issue of proportional representation. This is a promise that people want to see realized. How engaged do we need to be before Trudeau takes his own promise seriously? So everybody has their reasons. Everybody has their reasons for pushing proportional representation. It's not always a sexy issue. It's not always top of mind for most Canadians. But it is very sexy to some of us, you're right. It's foundational. It affects every decision that gets made in the House of Parliament. It's a foundational issue, and there's a crack in the foundation of Canada's democracy. This is why we're all here, and this is why we're all pushing for the government to make good on its promise. In the Green Party, we've always had strong environmental policies, strong social justice policies, and proportional representation has always been there in our platform because we realize to make sustainable change, to make long-term change, to make solutions that benefit the broadest possible group of people, you need to cooperate.
That's right!
Thank you. So Mr. Trudeau says he wants to ditch our electoral reform to keep us united. This is the word he's using now, unity. Pulling the rug out from under this process after a year of progress is not unity. Dropping your core election promise immediately after your cross-country listening tour is not unity. And it's not a coincidence. This is cowardice. For advocates of electoral reform, we've learned to celebrate the little victories. It was a big deal when this issue became a platform item on the Liberals' 2015 election platform. And I have to give a shout out to the Liberals for Fair Voting that were part of that process, internal to their party, that made that actually reach the platform. And a lot of young people, a lot of my friends, voted for the Liberals, a lot of us strategically, a lot of us swallowing our pride or feeling shamed, perhaps, into voting for the Liberals because they knew this would be the last time we'd have to go through with this. Lots of our friends. So that was one little victory that we could celebrate. We could celebrate another little victory when the committee to study proportional representation, electoral reform, the makeup of that part of that committee was changed. Originally, the Liberals wanted full control over the committee to study electoral reform, which was a bit of an irony. And after lots of pressure from people like you, they decided, yes, it does make sense to have the future of our democracy decided by a committee made up of different parties that have to work together. That made a lot of sense, and that was a little victory to celebrate. But we're not satisfied with just those little victories. We're not satisfied with being token members in a process that has gone nowhere so far. Mr. Trudeau, you do not get to take this from us now. You do not get to take this from us now. the system of democracy that we have with first past the post, winner take all, does not work in a multi-party system. You end up with two parties. We've seen this in the States. If you think that first past the post provides stable, good, broad-based policy, all you need to do is look south of the border. And Mr. Trudeau thinks that math will not work out here. We need less paranoid parties that are concerned about their own brands, and we need more parties that are willing to work together and willing to cooperate, and that's what proportional representation is all about. We want diversity in decision makers. We want cross-party cooperation. We want to stop being forced to vote strategically. We want the government to make good on its own promise. And for the last time, we want the government to listen for real this time. Thank you.
Thank you, Sam. Sam Nabi from the Green Party of Kitchener Centre. I'd like to introduce Catherine Fife. Catherine Fife, the Member of Provincial Parliament for Waterloo. NDP and Catherine have been a long-time supporter for electoral reform. Thank you, Catherine.
Good afternoon, everyone. I, too, would like to acknowledge that we are on the Haudenosaunee and Anishinaabe and Neutral People's Land. We have to remember that reconciliation is an active, ongoing process, and it's important for politicians to remember who they work for, who they serve, and where we are and how we got here. So let's go. I'm here today to share one experience with you. Many of you will know that I was elected during a minority government in 2012 when the then Ontario Liberals tried to buy a majority government here in the province of Ontario. Do you remember that?
Yes.
Well, when I entered that minority government, what I experienced was politicians who had to work together. We had to find consensus. We had to be collaborative. And we actually did a lot of good work in that minority government. And then we moved to a majority government where one party who got 40% of the vote has all of the power. And that rules out your voices in our democracy. So what I feel very strongly about is that first past the post is a direct threat to the democracy of this country and indeed of this province. So I want to thank you for being here today. It is important for us to hold all politicians, all parties, all governments to account. And as an activist politician, I feel it's important to stand up and represent the values and the principles that I feel. At the Women's March in Washington last month, some of you were there, thank you for that, feminist icon Gloria Steinem said that sometimes we have to put our bodies where our beliefs are. And you are doing that today, so thank you very much for that. There's a reason why people are cynical about the politics of this country. And we have so many examples of why first past the post has not served the citizens of this country. We have children on First Nations reserves living in third world conditions, which is a point of national shame for this country. Yes. We have politicians who said that they are not influenced by money and corporate influence, and yet we have a prime minister who happens to find himself in a room filled of billionaires looking for personal private contracts for long-term care. And we have a premier in the province of Ontario who is selling off your public asset, Hydro One. I can tell you that would not happen in a minority government or under a proportional representation because your voices would be represented in the legislature where you sent us to work for you.
You're right.
So it does need to be said, it needs to be said that Justin Trudeau, the Prime Minister of Canada, has betrayed the citizens of this country. And we need to hold him to account for that. My federal NDP counterparts are speaking out against the Liberal majority government's decision to back away from their campaign promise and throne speech commitment that 2015 would be the last federal election conducted under first past the post voting system. That was a moment of hope for the entire country. We believed those words when they were said. And we have a national sense of disappointment and cynicism because the Prime Minister has said it is his decision to back away from it. It is not Justin Trudeau's decision to back away. That is our decision to fight for our democracy. And while Trudeau wants the public to believe that there is no consensus on the way forward, the reality is that during the committee hearings, almost 90% of experts and public testimony called on the government to move forward with proportional representation. By not respecting those voices, he is not respecting the citizens of this country. And by being here today, you are reminding Justin Trudeau that we will hold him to account. We will not forget. This is not sunny ways for the province of Ontario or for Canada. So where do we go from here? Well, during the 2015 election, we elected three Liberal MPs who represent this riding and the Kitchener South Hespler and Waterloo. Well, those MPs stood on their place in the House and during that election, and they spoke in favor of proportional representation. They also said that they supported moving away from first past the post. So we have a job to hold those politicians to account and make sure that they remember their promise to us, which is to change the electoral system for this country and make our democracy stronger in doing so. Thank you very much.
Catherine Fife, MPP for the New Democrat Party in Waterloo. Proof that a cooperative government can work. I've been a member of Fair Vote since 2007 when we had the Ontario election. And I've been a little bit active here, you know, putting up signs, organizing a protest or two. But a real mover and shaker for Fair Vote is Anita Nickerson.
Thanks to all of you for coming out. It's wonderful to see such a big crowd. And I have to say that when Bob and I were doing tables in the park almost a decade ago, nobody knew what proportional representation was. Today, they say, sign me up. Okay, so we haven't won yet, but we've come a long way. So thanks to all of you for coming out to send our Liberal MPs in this area a strong message that this promise was not trivial. This promise was important to Canadians. This rally was not organized by Fair Vote Canada, the special interest group. This rally was grassroots. It was started by a lawyer and a doctor in Newfoundland and Labrador who, right after the 2015 election, started a Facebook group, which was called Trudeau Promised Electoral Reform. And almost overnight, starting with their five friends, 9,000 people joined onto this Facebook group to plan an event for April of this year when we would all be celebrating the promised legislation for electoral reform. And when Trudeau announced last week that he's breaking his promise, 27 rallies across Canada like this one sprung up almost overnight. So, I think the Liberals have miscalculated here. They made a crass political decision that we are expendable, that they can dispense with us, and we're here to say to each of those MPs and the Prime Minister who lied to me, who lied to you, that it's not that easy. So this week, Mr. Trudeau, after months and months of silence on this issue and making statements about how it wasn't all about him and he was going to be all open-minded and listen to the evidence and all that kind of lather that so many of us believed, this week he says that all forms of proportional representation are bad for Canada. So, he says, I'm not the kind of prime minister who's going to do something that's bad for Canada. So I want to ask him, are you the kind of prime minister who keeps your promises? Are you the kind of prime minister who listens to Canadians? Is he the kind of prime minister who can read a report? So basically what happened is he's dragged us through. Not only did he get millions of votes, people that believed that he really was going to do politics differently. But he dragged us through 6 months of a sham process, and when he didn't like the results, then he said that he's going to pull the plug. So on behalf of Fair Vote, I'm going to tell you that since it seems like reasoning, evidence, participation don't seem to count for a whole lot, what counts is votes. Our Liberal MPs need to understand that there's a lot more of us than they think there is. That there's a lot of people who voted for them, who voted together in 2015, who won't be voting together again unless the government reverses this decision now. There's still time for leadership. This is not dead. There's still time for us to show the government just how important this promise was. I think the one thing that upset me the most this week was when he said, Mr. Trudeau said, it was my choice to make. Okay? It was my choice to make. That kind of one man, one party, backroom boys show is exactly what millions of Canadians voted to get rid of. That is not consensus building. And as someone who's followed this process extremely carefully, I can tell you how many long days I've put watching every little piece of this process. I can tell you that the NDP and the Green Party have pretty much stood on their heads trying to get the Liberals to compromise on anything, to move even one inch. So building consensus, which Mr. Trudeau says there is none, that takes leadership. So we are demanding leadership from our Prime Minister, leadership from the Liberal government. So what can you do now? You can call your MP. Let's keep them busy all day answering the telephone from people like us. You can visit your MP. You can...
contact information for your MP.
Right. If we don't do it, who will? Don't go home and think somebody else will make the call, because it's not fun. Go home and make the call and keep their phone lines ringing, because they think that they can just sweep this under the rug and it's going to disappear with the media cycle, and it's up to each of us here to make sure that that doesn't happen. So I guess my message today is the government can reverse its decision. It must reverse its decision. It's time for them to show that real change means something. And I'm going to pass it over to Bob, who can, is it Jonathan now? Yeah, Jonathan.
Thank you, Anita. Anita is absolutely right. It is not too late. You can still make that change. I was told that Elections Canada needs about 2 years leave time to change the electoral system. The next election, next federal election, is in October 2019, which means that any electoral reform legislation needs to be passed by October of this year. There's plenty of time for legislation to be introduced to Parliament, to be debated, to be sent for second and third readings, to be passed by the Senate. And all it needs is some strong leadership from Prime Minister Trudeau. Yeah. Did you know that you can make your voice heard online? There is a petition. I saw the petition about a week ago. Nathan Cullen from the NDP sent out a tweet saying, please sign the petition. It was about 40,000 names on there. It took me a long time to get registered because the site was terribly, terribly slow. There were thousands, tens of thousands of people registering their names on that petition. Within a day, that was up to 50,000. A day later, to 70,000. Last night, I think it was just about 95,000. Today, it's 102,000 names on that petition. Yeah! Did you know that petition was originally introduced by somebody right from our own region of Waterloo here? Let's introduce Mr. Jonathan Castle, author of the petition for the federal government.
Hey everyone, thanks for coming. First of all, I'm Jonathan Castles, and it's great to see you all here. The thing that I want to say about myself, first of all, is that I am not an activist. I'm not a member of any political party. I am not involved, frankly, in any political group in any way. I'm someone who started a petition, really from nowhere. What happened, my story is that I was on social media, and a friend of mine posted an interview from Justin Trudeau. It was with Le Devoir, and it said that he was thinking about backing off of electoral reform. That's all it said. And my immediate reaction to this was, I need to do something. We need to do something. And the truth is that I didn't have any tools open to me. I did not have anything that I could do that I thought would make a big difference. But some of my friends got together and said, yes, you're right, we need to do something. What's an idea? And I started a petition. That petition has now grown to 105,000 signatures.
What?
105,000 signatures
for
electoral reform. So 105,000 signatures is the most signatures that any petition ever presented to Parliament has got in Canada. This is an issue that Canadians care about. Now, I could stand up here today and talk to you about all the things you know. I can tell you about how many Canadians have no representation in Parliament because of the system that we have today. I can tell you why proportional representation solves those problems, why we get more diversity, why we get less extremist groups. I could tell you all of those things, but you're the people who already know this. The thing that I want to tell you is that small things can matter. Small things. You can get together with a small group of people, do something that you have no idea where it's going to lead, and you can end up in a position like the one that I'm in. Just the other day, on Thursday, the NDP introduced a motion into the House asking for an apology. Asking for an apology from the Liberals, an admission that they misled Canadians. That motion can be traced directly back to a small 10-minute decision I made to start something that grew into something huge. I don't want to talk about the negative things that are going on right now. What I want to say is that every one of you knows something that you can do to forward this cause. If you don't, come to this tent right up here. They have ideas for you. They can talk to you about them. You can make a phone call. You can write a letter. You can send out a tweet. Heck, turn to three people around you right now, add each other to Twitter, and build a network. That's all it takes for us to find ways to make this change, to do something huge. I started off nowhere, and we have built this into something incredible. Absolutely incredible. And so my encouragement to all of you today is to take that step, to find that thing that you can do, which will make electoral reform happen. It's something we can do together.
All right.
Thank you.
Thank you, Jonathan Castles. It's citizens like Jonathan that will make electoral reform happen. I see a lot of familiar faces in the audience. People from Alliance Against Poverty. Yay, Alliance Against Poverty. The Food Not Bombs people are here. Around the corner, there is the vegan lunch bag people who are providing food for those people who can't afford it for themselves. These are the people that will benefit from electoral reform. I see David Lubell from the Council of Canadians. Council of Canadians has a brand new Kitchener-Waterloo chapter, and I'm hoping that David can come up and tell us something about that. I see people from environmental activists in Elmira, you know, gas plants that were put in place that nobody really wanted. Maybe somebody can speak to having a voice in government to be able to fight these things. I see people from industrial workers, I see people from office workers, everybody is represented here. I see people from what the government, what Justin Trudeau has called the fringe parties, people that need a voice in Parliament and aren't getting it because they don't get fair representation. So, at this point, this is a citizens' rally for electoral reform. I would like one of you, two of you, three or four of you to come up and let us know, let all of us know, how electoral reform can make your life better, can make the life better for you, your neighbors, and all the citizens of Canada. So, I'm willing to turn the mic over to somebody else. If not, is there anybody who brought a guitar? Is there anybody who brought a harmonica? We need some protest songs. Did anybody bring two sticks to beat together? We can use a bit of protest music. We've got them. I'd like to come up and take the microphone away from me. Then we can have a citizens' rally for electoral reform. Citizens, come up and say your piece. I see Mo Markham from the Animal Alliance. I see Oz Colcarnal. Oh, and I see Sharon Somerville from Fair Vote Waterloo as well.
It is great to see you today. We are so pleased. There are so many of us. Yes, bring the hat. Thank you. So, we did this on 3 days' notice, which is pretty amazing. Now, so, last winter, the Liberals had a fundraising device. It was this toque. The toque said, real change. So this toque says, real betrayal. So I am a Liberal. Before we didn't have members, well, we have supporters now, but I was a card-carrying Liberal. And my friend Jen Ross and I, under this table, hello Jen, we wrote this policy, Jen and I did, at the All-Star Sports Bar on Highland at Westmount. I am deeply invested in this process, and I am deeply invested in the Liberal Party, and I can tell you, I feel incredibly betrayed. I feel belittled. I feel insulted, and I am deeply insulted that Justin Trudeau thinks we are stupid enough to not recognize his 180 on this. In June of 2015, he was all about fair elections and making every vote count. And as of this week, he's mansplaining to us that we are at risk to have a fringe party elected through first past the post. Right, Justin. Did you not read the Electoral Reform Committee report? It is very clear that that is not the case. That is something we can design around. So, at this point, our job as citizens, as Canadians, and as Democrats is to push back as hard as we can, and that is what we are doing today. Yeah. And I would ask that everyone read today's record. There are three letters in support of electoral reform and an op-ed. Let's keep at it. So today, we start working harder than ever. So this week I got in the mail a letter from the Liberal Party that asked me to send them money. Oh yeah, like I'm gonna do that. So that letter included a self-addressed stamped envelope. So I am going to be sending back to the Liberal Party a letter that says, are you out of your mind? I will send you money when you make good on your electoral reform commitment. And I ask that if you got that little red envelope telling you that you are a very special person to them, that you do the same. And that you take a few moments to write to your MP and to your Prime Minister, and you tell them, that I will never vote Liberal again. You will never get any money out of me, and I will actively campaign against you.
Thank you.
Unless, of course, you give us electoral reform, and then we'll all be happy. So, onward, Waterloo Region!
My name is Katie. I volunteer with Ray of Hope and Homeless in Waterloo. In Canada, at this very minute, there are 235,000 people who are homeless. A full one-third of these people are under the age of 20. At 28, I am almost at the median survival age for a homeless person, which is 39. In BC, the price of a house that I live in on average is $2 million. This is ridiculous. We need change. We need affordable housing for these people because they have nowhere to go. At this moment, I am reminded of the great leader Mohammed Gandhi, who said, "We need to be the change we wish to see in the world. The only way we are going to affect change is if we stand up and say, we've had enough of the way things are."
Yes.
Homeless people are not homeless by choice. We had the downturn in the economy in 2008 because of people on Wall Street who thought they could get away with treating other people like dirt. This has got to stop. Our politicians have got to stop slinging mud at each other and work together in Parliament to effect real change that will better the lives of Canadian citizens. As a Liberal, I voted for Justin Trudeau. I was there at Conestoga College with a group like this when he said he would fight for change in Parliament to make the lives of every Canadian citizen better. I have not seen this. I have seen, on days like this, when I am walking the streets of Kitchener, people sitting outside of stores begging for change because they can't afford an apartment. This is not right. Every Canadian should be afforded a house. Every Canadian should be afforded the dignity of knowing they can afford to feed their families. We need change. What does change mean? Change means we need to stick together instead of ripping each other apart. Justin Trudeau campaigned on the promise that he would change what Stephen Harper was doing in politics of mudslinging at each other during the election. And while he did not insult Stephen Harper, he has insulted all of us, our intelligence, by going back on his promise to fight for us in Parliament. This is not right. Promises are meant to be kept, and kept they shall be, because we are going to stand up and say we've had enough. Look around you. The person standing next to you could be homeless, and you wouldn't even know it. When one-third of our Canadian citizens under 20 are homeless, and a full 235,000 people across Canada are homeless, this is not right, and it needs to change, and it needs to change now.
Thank you, Katie. Proportional representation will make those voices heard. Oz Colternow.
My name is Oz Colternow. I belong to the Alliance Against Poverty, but I'm speaking today as a citizen. How many here are willing to really struggle for proportional representation? Let's have a show of hands. Okay. I'll be very brief. This rally will pass. The petition. How many would be willing to occupy the offices of our Liberal MPs? Sit in until they change. All right, I've got your hands. I'm willing to do it. Let's do it then. Thank you.
Hi there. I'm Mo Markham. I'm part of Fair Vote Canada. Thank you. I'm not that short.
Oh, sorry.
I'm part of Fair Vote Canada, also KW Peace and KW Animal Save. And I got involved in politics again. I hadn't really been involved until I went out to BC 2 years ago. I used to live in British Columbia. I lived there for 9 years, and I had been away for 7 years. And I was devastated at how dry and how awful British Columbia looks. We've watched the fires in California for years and years, and now the fires are in Washington State and Oregon, and they're in British Columbia and Alberta, and starting in Saskatchewan. We cannot live this way. The scientists tell us that climate change is what is making the fires in BC and Alberta. And there's the flooding that we've experienced in many provinces is also about climate change. We cannot continue in this way. And it lit a fire under my butt, I'll tell you. And it made me feel like we have to make change. And the only way to make that is to have proportional representation. Nothing has ever happened with First Past the Post. They're not making the changes. Stephen Harper was living in Calgary. When I flew home, I was on the island. When I was in Vancouver, I was on Vancouver Island for a week. There were fires about 30 kilometers away. I'm still using asthma inhalers now, 2 years later, after being within 30 kilometers of those fires. When I flew out of Vancouver, there were fires rolling in from Washington State. When I landed in Calgary to change planes, you couldn't see the mountains for the smoke. We're just getting used to what this is, but we can't get used to it. We have to fight. The European parliaments that have proportional representation are doing much better with meeting their climate change goals. We are not doing that. We're never going to do that with a party that has all of the power with less than 40% of the vote. We need proportional representation, and we are going to get it. Thank you.
Louise Atlantaine, Tulalin, Gespic District. My name is Louise Atlantaine. I'm a Mi'kmaq Métis woman, originally from the Atlantic coast. My country was recognized in 1610 by way of the Vatican Concordat. We were the first Christian nation in North America and the first one to experience the genocide of the indigenous people that swept through Jeffrey Amherst all the way to the Dakota Access area with the people at the Standing Rock Sioux. Goes right across Canada. I'm here today because I, as a Canadian voter and a current Canadian citizen, have a complaint I filed using the Consumer Bureau of Canada, because Canada is a corporation and they are violating the law with the First Past the Post system. And it goes as follows. The fundamental reason why we have the rule, no elector who has voted at an election may request a second ballot at that election. Okay, now this process exists to secure an equitable process so each vote counts. No person has more than two votes, say. The problem is that with the First Past the Post, once a winner is determined, the views of all the other voters are discarded. That means that the winning dominant party gets the right to represent in the House. And that ignores the voices of the individuals who voted for other parties. So it negates the function of simply one ballot per person when that takes place. If 20% of Canadian voters vote for a party, we need to see 20% representation of that party in the House so that our views are heard. Abuse of rights in the electoral process exists because voters are shareholders and taxpayers of Canada, and as such, they are entitled to be heard equally. If First Past the Post negates the voice of the taxpayers who voted for other parties, it is abuse of rights. It gives some shareholders more of a voice while completely disregarding the voice of others, and this bias continues systematically until the next election period. Now, the next law they're violating is called Abuse of Dominance. and it is fundamentally anti-competitive, and it prevents emerging competition from surfacing. That's what they're using right now with telemarketing and the cell phone issues. That's the same issue. It's called abuse of dominance. It works like this. Abuse of dominance, as outlined in Section 78 and 70 of the Competitions Act, establishes the bounds of legitimate competitive behavior and provides corrective actions when firms engage in anti-competitive activities that damages or eliminates competitors and that maintains or entrenches or enhances their market power. So with First Past the Post, it serves as anti-competitive deterrent for emerging parties with new ideas who often lack the same funding, volunteers, and support that long-established parties have. As a result, many voters feel stuck in a binary system with the two top parties racing for position, whereas all those who vote for alternative parties, the smaller parties, get locked out. They feel that if they vote, their vote is wasted, so they have no choice but to vote for either party A or B in order to be represented. And that is fundamentally anti-competitive, and that creates a disconnect between the shareholders and the Corporation of Canada. And that's why our system is broken today. We are shareholders. We deserve an equal voice. We deserve proportional representation. And that is fundamentally the law. And that's what we got to call them to. It's a corporate law. It's our law. Use it.
Thank you, Lulu. Aline Nathu, come on up, Aline.
Hello, everyone. I want to thank everyone in the regional municipality of Waterloo for coming out and rallying for the electoral reform. Thank you so much. I also just wanted to say that when it comes to our Prime Minister Justin Trudeau, who decided to backpedal on electoral reform, I was going to say one thing is he doesn't want to be held accountable for his actions. And what we need to do as citizens is we need to continue to lobby our Liberal government and hold them to account. I will give an example of one of Justin Trudeau where he has broken the ethics rules. One of them is when he flew over to the Aga Khan Island. So, and this happened over the Christmas holidays. He did not report that to the ethics commissioner. So Justin Trudeau is spending more of his time on lobbyist islands instead of rallying for the people. And I was also reading on the Rebel Media that in 2014 he did the exact same thing too. So what we need to do is we need to take back our country and put it back to the people. And also I wanted to say that we need to also respect our Canadian Charter of Rights and Freedoms and ensure that every person in Canada, regardless of their age, gender, race, religion, sexual orientation, color, or disability, gets treated fairly and equally under the law. With proportional representation, we will ensure that every person has a voice in the government. So I want to thank everyone for coming out, and I'm going to turn it back over to Bob, and I hope you all have a great, lovely day.
Thanks, Aline. Next up, Richard Walsh.
Good afternoon, everybody. I'm Richard Walsh, member of the Alliance Against Poverty, and I was the Green Party candidate in Waterloo in the 2015 federal election. Friends, I have a couple of brief remarks. One is historical, the other is political. With regard to history, over the decades, throughout the 20th century, and now here in the 21st century, the House of Commons, in one form or another, at various points, has studied the question of the nature of Canadian democracy, and each time when the study was completed, the conclusion was the same. Proportional representation was the recommendation. The history of deliberations by the House of Commons throughout the 20th, and now the first couple of decades of the 21st century is identical. Namely, consistently, Parliament recommends proportional representation as the most appropriate form of democracy for this nation. Let us not ignore that history. But proportional representation, in my opinion, is not an end in itself. Rather, if Canada introduces a system of proportional representation, and we will work really hard by putting lots of pressure, as Oz suggested, on our local MPs to ensure that it occurs, if proportional representation is instituted in Canada, then what we really need to be doing as a nation, as a region, as ordinary citizens, is to work diligently toward achieving environmental, economic, and social justice throughout the land. If we don't have a political framework based on human liberation, then all the proportional representation that we might obtain will come to naught if we persist in perpetuating injustice and a militarized, industrialized economy. It is the nature of our society for which we should be struggling. It is our vision for the future that should inspire us not only to achieve the institution of proportional representation, but to go beyond that on the basis of that democratic platform to achieve justice and peace for this and all future generations. Thank you.
Thank you, Richard. Duncan, come on up.
Hi, I'm Duncan, and I have no particular political affiliation, but I know what issues I care about, and I know that I do not like being gaslit by the people that I elect, because that's not great. Anyways, I thought I'd just come up here to repeat a point that I heard someone say online. Justin Trudeau's worried that Kelly Leach will have her own party if we allow her to. I say, let's let Kelly Leach have her own party so we can start ignoring her. Because as it stands, the only reason why Kelly Leach has any legitimacy right now, or Kevin O'Leary, or anyone else running for the Conservative leadership, is because of how they have the potential to actually win the leadership. If we don't want to give legitimacy to these fringe voices, give them their own party so we can start ignoring them. That's pretty much it.
Hi everybody, my name is Paul. I'm going to try and keep this short. How many of us are feeling a little frustrated at what the Liberals have done? So let's start with a bit of optimism here. We are making progress. You know how we're making progress? Because over this 6 months, more people know about proportional representation, more people know about first past the post than before. After 2007, we worked on the Ontario campaign. A week after that, a campaign failed. Not a peep. Now we've got this rally, and we've got lots of media coverage, and we can keep this going. But a lot of us still might be feeling frustrated. What do we do? So we heard some very concrete things already. Speak to your MP. I had a couple of other ideas. First of all, and Occupy, here's a few other ideas. How many people in total filled out that mydemocracy.ca survey? 300,000 or something? How many people have signed this petition so far? 102,000. Wouldn't it be interesting if we could get 300,000 people to sign this petition? How do we do that as individuals? Well, we have friends, we have family, we have neighbors. We're not at this rally. Who might be very frustrated about the political system, but not be able to articulate it as being first past the post. So we can tell those people, we can get them involved, and we can get them signing too. Secondly, how many of us voted last time? Most of us? Let's do a little funnel. How many people consider themselves politically active? How many people worked on a campaign? How many people worked on the Liberals and are willing to admit it? Few people. You know what? The reason the liberals can think they can get away with this is because they think that people are ignorant and they think people won't care. And they think that the next time that there is an election, they're going to say, oh, you can vote for us, but a vote that's not for the liberals is a vote for the conservatives. And we're tired of that rhetoric, and it's going to happen election after election after election unless we hold them to account. How do we hold them to account? The ones that they got really angry by breaking their promise are exactly the ones who know how first past the post work, who know how politics works, and who are politically active. We have no obligation to help our local MPs get re-elected next time. And when 2019 comes rolling around and they're saying you have to vote for the Liberals or you get some terrible hellfire future, we can work for somebody else. So let's keep that in mind and let's keep educating our friends and our neighbors and our family so that next time this comes around, more people will know about first past the post, about proportional representation, about electoral reform, and they won't be able to pull out this excuse that Canadians don't care.
Thank you, Paul. Paul is my mentor. It was thanks to Paul that I first heard about Fair Vote Canada. He got me involved in 2007 for the Ontario referendum, and he's been keeping at me, and I've been going ever since. Thank you very much, Paul, for helping me out with this. Kevin, come on up. Kevin is the secretary for Fair Vote Waterloo.
Hi, folks. Just wanted to talk a wee bit more about what happened in 2007. We had a referendum then, and we had 37% support for proportional representation. And they said, oh, no, that's not high enough. It needs to be 60%. But guess what? If you have like 37% support, you can get a majority government. You can get 100% of the power. So yeah, you can't make major decisions like electoral reform with 37% of the vote, but what you can do, you can get rid of the Canada Wheat Board and sell it to the Saudis. You can take away protections for all the rivers and streams in Canada. You can privatize Hydro One. There's a lot of things you can do with that level of support if you got 100% of the power. So I'd say it's time for things to change and for everyone to have a voice at the table. Thanks.
Thanks, Kevin. Another word to Katie?
So, we all want change. What does this mean? It means we stand up, we say we've had enough. We call our MPs, we tell them we've had enough. We write to them, we tweet to them, we Facebook to them. We get our friends to go on, we get our friends to write to them, to tweet to them, to Facebook to them, and we say we've had enough, that we want proportional representation in Parliament so every Canadian has the chance to have their voice heard. When we have people who don't have their voice heard in Parliament, that is not democracy. The very definition of democracy means, under the Canadian Charter, that every citizen of this country, regardless of who they are, should have their voices heard. This is a fundamental right for every Canadian citizen. And when it's not being met, then we have a problem.
And final word goes to Martin Suter.
Hi, I'm a member of the Alliance Against Poverty, and these cards and petitions and online petitions, they're all great things. I'm not downplaying them at all, but unfortunately, since we have this 100% majority government with 39% of the vote, I think the Liberals will do the very best to simply just ignore the petitions and cards and everything else because we don't matter to them. And I think I'd like to second Oz's call for some stronger direct action. I think occupying the MP's office of Bartosz and Sani, that would get their attention. I think we really need to organize something like that.
I was wrong. Final word goes to Laura Hamilton. Laura is a member of the West Waterloo and food dot com.
Very briefly, I just want to say, if anyone is talking to you about this issue, we won't have meaningful action on climate change until we change the electoral system. It simply won't happen. We'll have political compromises because of the influence of the oil industry in Canada, and so it has to happen. And I also wanted to say that we made a lot of extra crisp for you folks today because we knew you were coming. So there's lots of extra food with Food Not Bombs, and we always need drivers. I had to make the pitch. And if anyone ever wants to cook with us, we always need people to do that. So go talk to the lovely folks there. And thank you, Fair Vote, for organizing this. You're amazing.
All right. Final words from Aidan Seaman.
Hi, everyone. My name is Aidan Seaman. It's great to... Real betrayal. It's nice to see so many people out here today. The thing that I am most interested in getting proportional representation for is to ensure political stability. And Justin Trudeau says that he is concerned about fringe parties, small fringe parties ruling parliament. Well, how about if one of the major parties drifts so far to the right that they become a fringe party? I'm really concerned about that. And by having more voices in parliament, better representation of people's political views across Canada and parliament, I think that would prevent right-wing extremism from ever creeping into parliament and causing terrible things to happen in Canada. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Ian. Sharon tells me that Rod Saini is having a potluck tomorrow at his office. You know, go here to Food Not Bombs, grab yourself some apple crisp or fruit crisp, grab yourself some soup, and then tomorrow, go do it all over again at Rod Saini's office. Rod Saini made the claim that really nobody has come to him to let him know that people are concerned about electoral reform. But I know that many people have written to him, have emailed him, have met with him in person. Go meet him tomorrow. Go grab a postcard there. And the other postcard, a lovely picture of Justin Trudeau on here. Let Justin Trudeau know that we, the citizens of Canada, want electoral reform. We want fair representation. That's Raj. This is Raj. Raj here, Justin here. We've got both postcards over at the table there. On your way past there, go grab some apple crisp. Thank you very much for coming out here today, for letting everybody know nationally. We had the media out here, so that was a good thing. Letting everybody know that citizens, not special interest groups, but citizens all over the place want fair representation. They want electoral reform. Final word.
I want to thank you all for coming out very much. I'd like to address Trudeau's and the Liberals in general's incompetence on my right to use cannabis. We all know that the parents of Justin Trudeau sat behind office with a big fat doobie smoking cannabis for their whole term. Now, I'm going to get bent over by the judicial system for doing the same thing. Bull! It is my body, it is my right, and I'm not talking about setting up infrastructure now, 10 years from later. I want it right now, okay? It's a personal choice, and we can go and get loaded because alcohol is regulated by the LCBO. Alcohol is regulated, and we're sitting here watching Kathleen Wynne, who, in my opinion, represents an ostrich. That's not fair. My right to use cannabis is right now, and I'm not going to get bent over and denied my right to do that. Thank you.
Everybody's voice needs to be heard. Thank you very much. Grab some postcards. Let everybody know, let their MPs know that we want electoral reform.
We want electoral reform!
We